Nina is a world-class designer. She's a graphic designer. She's worked at some of the biggest studios, most successful studios in the world, in London, Oslo, Sydney. And she now has her own successful design business on the Sunshine Coast. Nina has been on a spiritual journey since 1999, when she first went to India. She has spent extensive time in India and Thailand practicing meditation, yoga of the Tantric tradition. Today, Nina is very involved in teaching people Tantric sexuality. Is everybody listening now? She's very much excited about the prospect of the awakening of the divine feminine, helping women awaken their sexual energy. Yes, let's hear it. She runs the Art of Love Tantric Workshop, which is a workshop based on Tantric sexuality. I know you're all very disappointed to hear there's actually no sexual contact in the workshop or no nudity. So Nina's also teaching yoga. She's held countless courses, retreats, facilitated workshops. She's been teaching the Tantric path for over 10 years. Probably Nina's greatest gift is her open heart. Everyone that comes into contact with Nina is quite charmed by her non-judgmental, compassionate way of living. She's really an example to all of us of the path of the heart, the gift of the heart, and everyone is touched by her soft nature. And today she'll be talking about this idea of transforming negative emotions. We've all had negative emotions. Let's be real about it. Let's be authentic. But what should we do with them? Should we ignore them? Should we run away from them? Should we amplify them? Should we suppress them? Should we be with them? What does being with a negative emotion mean? Let's hear more from Nina Hansen, the inner alchemist.
Thank you very much, Anthony. I was a little bit curious to see what we're going to see as my intro, because as you probably know, I am Anthony's partner, and he's a little bit of a larger-than-life character, and sometimes things comes out of the mouth before it's gone through the head sometimes, so it's always a little bit of an excitement to see what's going to happen. So we're going to talk about some beautiful aspects that comes from the Tantric tradition, primarily. Now, sometimes in the world of yoga and spirituality, people argue if it's Tantric or if it's Vedantic, and let's just kind of chuck all of that out of the window. My background is Tantra, so I sort of see a lot of the things under there, but there's definitely millions of crossovers in all these different professions. So this is often what our life looks like, an emotional roller coaster. So this might be the 1 year of our life. It could be 1 week. Or sometimes one day. Wake up really good, get a phone call, bang, kind of recover a little bit and whatever. So first of all, emotions are a very important part of our life. There is nothing wrong with emotions. They are a very important part of what serves us in this life. They're like a communication between our inner world and our outer world, and the outer world and inner world. It's like kind of a very important part of how we perceive reality. But what they are supposed to do is that they are supposed to serve us. And sometimes it seems like we are serving the emotions. They take us over and they don't get to be a tool in our life. So we all dream about a perfect life. This is me. This is my perfect life. In a hammock in Thailand looking at the sunset. And this is a very special tropical island because there's no mosquitoes there. Because it's the perfect life. And we all have these dreams, and sometimes that dream might incorporate, I have my beautiful, have I turned it on? No. Yes. So maybe there is a property in the hinterland, the mortgage is paid off all together, I don't have all the money in the bank that I need, so I don't have to work anymore unless I need to. I have a partner. Every day we agree about everything. It's just paradise. And that will be the ideal world, right? So this is all an external fantasy, But what does that external fantasy really encompass? It's an inner quality, right? It's a place where I am not emotionally challenged in that way anymore, where my emotion seems to be above a certain level, where I don't keep kind of crashing down. Because the reality is that when we look at people that we know, and even people that seem to have achieved everything that we want, and even if we look at famous people, you know, they're famous for a while and then they end up in rehab. So really, life maybe wasn't that good after all. There doesn't really seem to be anything in this physical world that actually creates that mosquito-free tropical island. So the ancient yogis, they were really clever guys, and they, or girls, and they actually discovered that this life that we're living, it is a school of consciousness. It's like a school. It's basically, we're here, this is all a classroom, even if we're not in a conference in this setting. The minute you step out of bed, or even when you're dreaming, you're actually going through a school of consciousness. And that this school of consciousness, we're all the time walking this walk, trying to find a place of inner peace. So no matter what we're doing, no matter what we're searching for, we're looking for a place where we feel better, where things are greater, where we feel more at peace. So even the guy that nicked my bike 2 months ago, he did that because he thought his life in that moment will be better. Even when we look at someone that's a really stressed out career person, he's doing it because deeply inside he thinks he's going to get better, thinks he's going to feel better, even if it's because I need that job or if it's because I need that new car, and then life will be better. So we're all the time like threading this path, and some of us might find that at some stage it's like, I don't desire a really big car or a really big house. It's like you start looking on the inside, and that's really what the spiritual path often is referred to. So alongside this search, the yogis, they find that they were kind of crazy, and they used their own body and mind as a laboratory, and they found lots of crazy positions of the body and things that we can do that helped us to harmonize the energy within our being. And by harmonizing that and changing the way that things flow in the body, it sort of takes out the emotional challenges that life brings. It just takes the edge off them and makes things just that little bit easier and a little bit more enjoyable. So they studied the universe, and I just wanted to say one thing about this with yoga, which, you know, when Anthony and I started studying yoga many, many years ago, we had a fantastic teacher, and yoga was all about the mystical things, like it was about the mystical things of the mind, of the universe, the unknown, and using yourself as this kind of amazing vehicle to explore all of these things, because yoga is a methodology. So there's not really such a thing as philosophy in yoga. So there is a word in the yogic tradition called darsana, and it's often referred to as philosophy, but it actually means intuitive experience of the truth through yoga. So really, when someone shows you something, even what I'm saying today, don't believe what I say, go and test it. And when it becomes truth for you, then you have a state of darsana, and that's what it really is all about. So they discovered that the universe is an ocean of energy. And everything, including the chairs we're sitting on, the stage that I'm standing on, to the air we're breathing, to the stars, and everything is energy, including our physical body. And that the emotions that we experience are different manifestations of energy. And the yogis were really clever, and they even realized that different forms of energy are different forms of manifestation of energy, or the other way around. Energy manifesting as different forms of emotions. And to understand a little bit of what I'm going to talk about now, I'm going to quickly introduce you to the seven chakras. So everyone's heard about the seven chakras. They become a bit of a cult thing. But in the tantric tradition, they were a really important part of understanding the psyche of the human being. Because each of these seven chakras, they sort of have a function in the physical body and in the emotional body, the energetic body, and it goes all the way deep into our consciousness, and they kind of have both emotions and mind on their own. So if we start with the root chakra is sort of placed right in the perineum of the human being, and they is actually the battery of the human being. So it's the seat of our vitality. It's where the human being draws his physical and mental vitality. So this is really important part of our being, right? Because today we all talk about getting more vitality. We're all a little bit tired. It's like we don't get enough. We don't have enough juice. So people with a big Muladhara chakra, they often have a lot of physical vitality. Emotionally, it gives us sort of endurance, stability. It's like the energy of the elephant. It's a bit slow to get going, but once you get going, it can keep on going. So on the negative side, however, it can be a little bit heavy, forgetful, kind of dense, kind of swamped in the material world, be a bit greedy, my big four-wheel drive, my big house and my big bank account, and just put a big fence around it, and it kind of gets a bit dense. The second chakra, Svadhisthana chakra, the black sheep of the family, because obviously it's related with the sexual organs, because it's placed just above the sexual organs of the women and insertion of penis for men. So really this is like the chakra that you don't find much written about in the spiritual books, because most forms of spirituality, they have ignored the part of sexuality, but not Tantra, because we like it. So we have here a very complex part of the human being, and a very challenging one. And the reason for that is the seat of the instincts. So where our instincts is kind of so much of our life is driven by instincts if we actually analyze it. So this is where we find a lot of beautiful things with creativity, sensuality, sexuality, social grace. But on the little bit of a negative side, we find depression, forms of anxiety, we can find addiction, fear of not being good enough, keeping up with the Joneses. So big polarities in this chakra between things that are very enjoyable and things that are very challenging. The third one, Manipura chakra, which is just below the navel, the seat of the fire in our human being, and beautiful emotions in this part. Willpower, strength, you know, the people that stand alone, big bosses, always got big Manipura. That's why sometimes it's hard to understand how they think, because they think a little bit different from the masses. The masses, where are they? In the water, in the second chakra. Because these guys, they've got something that the others don't have. It's like they got this, you know, everybody else believes in that. I believe in this. I don't really care, because I dare to stand alone. So they hypnotize the others tends to follow the third chakra. So beautiful, we all need that. Willpower, strength, you know, all of these things, we want that, right? But on the negative side, anger, ego, violence. So all the things that can be very much related with the sort of fiery part of the temperament. Next chakra, Anahata chakra, the heart chakra in the center of the chest, related with air, selflessness, self-love, self-acceptance, empathy. There's nothing negative to say about this part of the being. It's kind of a place that we all truly aspire to be. Next one, Vishuddha chakra. Hard to talk about emotions on this level. Higher aesthetics like architecture, cathedrals, the feeling of beautiful classical music, intuition, very much related with this one. The next one, third eye, clairvoyance, clarity of mind. The mind of a Zen master, Zuk. Sometimes people say in spirituality, they come to my yoga class and say, I can't work on my mental chakra because I'm already so much in the mind. My mind is like fluctuating all the time. But you see, all these energy centers, they have a mind on their own. This chakra, the third eye, that's the mind of a Zen master, 100% clear, 100% sharp the whole time. The mind that's fluctuating and doesn't really know where it's standing, that's the mind of the lower chakras. So the third eye, clarity, and the seventh one, very beautiful, pure consciousness, pure awareness. It's kind of a place beyond almost these realities, where we connect to what's beyond this physical reality, our deeper self. So that's all very interesting, but how are we going to now talk about this in relationship to the emotions deeper? Well, as you probably noticed on that slide, is that the three lower chakras had the biggest juxtaposition between challenging or lower and not such and good emotions. Whereas from the heart and up, we don't have a lot of very challenging emotions. Life is pretty cool, actually. Now, yoga has this amazing secret, the knowledge in it, that if we energize the higher chakras, they rule the lower. The upper always rule the lower, but not if they're depleted from energy. And the big challenge in our time is that maybe the primarily consciousness of this planet is in the lower three chakras. So we all fluctuate, but you know, we talked about this, I think Mary mentioned it, this planet is what, 78% water, and so are we. So it's very natural that our consciousness would naturally kind of drizzle down into the lower chakras. So it's kind of our challenge. If you study really yoga deeply, you'll see that they have like a special mandala for each chakra. And they sort of have a flower and different symbols. But part of that symbol is to have some deities, and one of them is always sitting like this. And it means go higher, because the consciousness, the possibilities of the human being is so much greater when we go higher. So we have this amazing thing in yoga which is called sublimation, and that's just a term that's borrowed from science. And sublimation means that you take something that is kind of dense and physical and you make it, turning it to something more refined. So I'm walking out of the spotlight. I'm telling everyone not to walk out of spotlight. I walked out of spotlight. So really, it's turning something dense into something more refined. So we can shift the energy within our being, and then we're literally shifting the consciousness. And it's actually really quite instant. This is the magic of yoga. And you know, even after having done yoga for God knows since 99, so many years, I'm still amazed sometimes. I used to teach yoga after I'd been to my design job. Sometimes I was an art director, and it was quite stressful. You know, I was having to make lots of decisions, and really I wanted to go home and be a couch potato, but I had to go and teach my yoga class. And I will do one pose, and another one. And then everything will fall into place, because it literally is magic. It's kind of like an automatic thing that happens in the body, because it's almost like a magic ritual. And what it's doing is harmonizing, and a lot of what it's doing is shifting the energy upwards, particularly when we go upside down. That's why you stand on your head. It's like a mechanical way of bringing the energy upwards. And then you get to experience more of life through the upper chakras, and it just takes the edge of the challenge. It doesn't mean that you don't have those things. It doesn't mean that you can't see them, but you have other tools to also deal with them, which is from the heart. So that kind of little tinge of jealousy that you may experience is kind of taken care of by the heart, with empathy, with love, and so forth. And this is really a process that we are really quite used to. It happens in life all the time. You take something very dense, like crude oil, you put it through a refinery, and it becomes electricity, which is almost kind of untouchable. It even becomes light, right? Which is also can be measured as energy, which is even more refined than, you know, the kind of actually firing that goes on in there. Or you can imagine a block of ice becoming water and becoming steam. So it's actually a process that happens all the time, and it happens within the human being as well. So energy itself is neutral. We're all the time collecting energy from this universe that surrounds us, from the food that we eat, from the ground, from the space that surrounds us. We're actually kind of all the time plugged in to the universe, and it's like sucking in energy. And wherever it goes, it comes into our being, and wherever the river beds are kind of has the biggest grooves, that's where it's going to go. So if that's kind of for your lower part of your being, that's where we'll go. With conscious practices like energy work, such as yoga, we can start bringing that energy upwards and therefore create new patterns that to deal with reality, new energy reaction patterns and so forth. So that's just one of the most amazing things that all the sort of Asian traditions like Tai Chi, yoga and so forth, it gives us some very practical tools to balance and harmonize. And it really is not that difficult. You don't have to be super flexible to do this. There's very simple yoga poses that are so valuable, but the only thing you have to do it. You can't read a book about it, you can't go to a lecture about it, you've got to literally sit down on the floor and do your stuff yourself. Okay, Nina, that's interesting, a little bit of yoga knowledge, but I kind of enjoy the ups and downs of life. You know, I think it's kind of who I am. What's so wrong about it? Shouldn't life, I don't think I have to be Captain Chuckle all the time. It's quite a good place to be. I like to play the Smiths and memorize about some shitty times sometimes, drink a glass of wine, and I don't mind it. Well, let's have a little look at what science has to say about this. So there's a beautiful form of science called epigenetics. There's a guy called Bruce Lipton that's kind of one of the really famous people that talks about this, and he's written a book called Biology of Belief, and it's just fascinating. If you like that sort of spirituality / science connection, recommend it. If you take a stem cell, which is part of the cells in the human being that keeps renewing itself, and you put it in a little plastic dish and you give it a good environment so it's happy, it will keep multiplying, and after a certain amount of time you can have thousands of stem cells, and they are exact identical cells, right? They come from the same genes. It's just that one cell that's become lots of cells. So they're like a little clone of itself, if you could call it that. Then you take the same cells from the dish with many cells and put them into three different little plastic dishes, and you give them different environments. And what happens? they actually become different cells. So isn't that interesting? Because we've been made to believe that our genes are determining who we are and what we become. And that's kind of gone so far to that some people actually have preventive surgery removing their breasts because they have genes that might give them breast cancer. And they think that my percentage is so high, let's just cut off my body. But this research shows that that was a really bad idea. Put them back very quickly, because it's actually the environment that determines what happens to the cells, not your genes. Because these cells actually come from exactly the same identical cell, and they became different cells in the body, like fat cells or muscle cells or whatever else the body needs in that context. Okay, that's also very interesting, but it seems like a bit of a sidestep. What's it got to do with emotions? Well, if we take some identical cells again and put them into two different dishes, and in one dish we give them the environment of love, the cells, they grow really beautiful. So when I say the environment of love, I mean all the beautiful chemistry that the body produces, like oxytocin, whatever. We can sort of replicate that sort of in a mechanical way. The cells, they grow beautifully. They thrive and they grow and they become beautiful, lots of beautiful, happy cells. And if we put them in the dish with fear, what happens is they actually shrink. They go into protection mode. So this is like the Amy Cuddy walk. They kind of do this. And the body shrinks up and they actually eventually will probably die. So isn't that interesting that we can actually create that environment and this is what happens to the cells? And why is it really so interesting? It's because we are a community of nearly 40 million cells. So that's us. We are a massive big plastic dish, and the environment, our environment, is changing all the time. So sometimes, you know, we might be spit out of the same mother, come from the same place, same genes, same mom, same dad, same upbringing, and you turn out so differently. Why? It kind of baffles you sometimes. Why should it be like that? Shouldn't we be much more the same? I have a sister, she's really different. I do yoga, I eat organic food, you know, all high and mighty, and she smokes, she's a hairdresser, she has a bottle of red wine too much. You shouldn't even think we came from the same place. She's lovely, I love her. But we're very, very, very different. And interesting, but then I really want to know then who creates this environment, because that's me. I'd like to have a say in that. Well, it's your brain. Say hello to the chemist of your life. This brain keeps releasing chemicals all the time. And the body is so ridiculously complex, it's just overwhelming. You know, we kind of think in modern, you know, the sort of normal medical system today that we know so much about the body. We know really nothing. We know so little. So the brain keeps continuously spewing out chemicals that makes you react in a certain way. So what happens is the mind, the bigger part of your perception, you know, your senses, your beliefs, everything, is kind of coming together, and they are giving impressions to your brain, and the brain produces chemicals that flushes through your body. Spider, woo, or spider, meep, meep, meep. So you're actually the one that decides by this kind of whatever happens within yourself. Maybe you had a pet spider as a kid and you think they're cute. Maybe you're from Norway like me and you run, because we don't have stuff like that. So really, the chemistry of your body is determined by what happens in your mind, by your beliefs. So isn't that interesting? Your environment is actually what overrides even your genes. So this puts a whole new perspective on the whole kind of victimization that we may feel in terms of being sort of trapped in the human body, that you actually have the potential to make huge change in your life. But did you hear the one word that I said that's so important? Your beliefs. So if you don't believe that, you don't have that power. So that's a very, very important part. So your beliefs is actually kind of primarily what's going to change the chemistry within your being. Okay, so if that's my mind, my bigger perception organ that sort of perceives this reality, let's have a little quick look at how that actually works. So we're going to sort of say here roughly that the mind has two different parts in this context. One is the rational mind, and this rational mind is really good. It goes to Paradigm Shift Summit, it goes to self-help workshops, it becomes a better me all the time. It reads books, it learns, it's a really good part of your being. It's usually have great aspiration, and it's pretty switched on. What's the problem with it? It's only really with us maybe 5 to 10% of the time. What's it doing the rest of the time? It's dreaming, thinking about what I did yesterday, dreaming what it's going to do tomorrow, what it's going to have for lunch today, looking forward to the clean towels that they put in your room. It just has all these things that it thinks about. Or maybe something happened last night that it didn't like, still having a bit of a bitch about that up here. Whatever it's doing, it's all the time fluctuating between the past and the future. Only maybe 5 to 10% have we got it with us. So that's kind of a bit shocking, because the rest of the time, the rest of the time, this bugger is ruling your life, which is the subconscious mind. So who and what is the subconscious mind? Ooh, that's a big question. Well, that's your big genie, the big shadow behind you. So a lot of you probably would be familiar with the subconscious mind. It rules all the unconscious functions in your body. So it makes your heart beat, your blood rush around, all the stuff that we can't really feel like we control ourselves. So that's why it's called subconscious mind, because it's, we're not really conscious of it, right? But it does so much more than that. You know, when you go home from work and you do kind of tasks that you do all the time, and that mind goes off on the trail and dreams and you're driving your car, who's driving the car? The subconscious mind's driving the car. You didn't drive the car, you can't even remember maybe like 5K. And you just wake up and you're suddenly at home. And who drove the car? The subconscious mind is really clever. It can do all sorts of stuff. Sometimes it takes me for a walk on the beach. And I'm actually intending to go for a walk on the beach and do like my conscious meditation. And I come home to the other side of the beach and I realize my subconscious mind went for a walk and I've been dreaming about something I'm going to do later on in that day. So the subconscious mind is a really clever cookie. But the crazy thing about the subconscious mind is that it is primarily pre-programmed with lots of programs and reaction patterns, emotional reaction patterns and so forth, by the time we're 7. Oh, really? And it actually works like this, because up until the age we're 7, our brain spends a lot of its time in the lower brain frequencies, and this is nature's way of making you fit into the environment that you're born into. So if you're born into like a really rough environment, you're gonna grow up and become a rough cookie. If you brought up doing ballet and playing the piano, then you're going to be a ballet playing piano, a refined little creature, because that's the environment that you're born into. It's very clever like this. But it means that because this part of our being is actually ruling our life maybe 90% of the time, it's so hard to change. So I'm sitting there really fresh in the morning the night before, and I'm going to do yoga every morning half an hour this week. And then next morning comes, I'm like, rawr. Can't really do it, because you can't really step into that conscious part of yourself. It does other things as well. It keeps putting in new patterns by retraining the mind by habit. So things that you do all the time. So that's a good way of actually retraining this part of your mind, is habitually doing things. The only thing is that so many of those habitual thoughts and so on, they're actually bubbling up from the subconscious mind. So it's the architect of your life. And it's not just the architect of your inner life, but it's also the architect of your outer life. So if you're the kind of person that likes to go, we all know someone like this that goes, oh, it's so bad, you know, every time I go to my local supermarket, I can never get a park. Parking there is terrible. He'll make sure, because he goes, your wish is my command. She doesn't want to have a park when she goes to the shopping center. So I'm going to make sure she gets in the car when it's all full. And you get there, and you get to confirm this dream of never having a car park at the supermarket. Or other things in your life. So you might go, okay, but I like to know what's in there. Well, then look at your life. What is in your life? Do you have the feeling, oh, I do good, honest work. I work hard, but I earn a living. So that's nothing wrong with that, if that's what you want to have. And you might look at someone else and you go, oh, they are almost like cheats because they make all this money out of nothing. So if that's your belief, then you're not going to make money easily, because you actually have a resistance towards it. So when we look at our life, and it can be very confronting, you know, self-discovery is not just about discovering how great we are, it's also sometimes discovering things that we have to leave behind. So the subconscious mind, when we look at our life, we can very much see what's actually happening in there, because that's a manifestation of what's going on in our life. So how can I change these programs? Because I'd like to do that. We all want to do that. Because we all, there's nobody, none of you would be here at Paradigm Shift if you didn't have aspirations to kind of be both or greater on the inside. Let's have a look at how the mind works. The mind works very much in the same way as the wind. So when it's a really windy day, what's happening? The air is moving, right? and it's blowing and blowing, and as long as the air is moving, it's a really windy day. What happens when the wind stops? Where's the wind? Is there still wind? It's not, it's just still air, right? So the wind only exists when it's moving. And the same with the mind. As long as the mind is thinking and doing stuff and dreaming, it's existing. When it stops, where is the mind? You're in a state of no mind. You're in a state that is beyond the mind. So you're actually already then accessing a part of yourself that is the deeper part of your consciousness. And it's a very beautiful state. So I'd planned that we're actually going to do a little bit of a breathing thing here, but you already did it twice yesterday. So we did it with Anthony when we did the breathing thing. And we also did it with Phil. So what happens, even if we just close our eyes and breathe consciously for maybe 7 breaths, we feel different. Why? Because you stepped out of this mind that's just like a storm, a windy storm the whole time, and you went into a place of pure stillness. A beautiful place of stillness, where there is actually no mind. And it's a wonderful place to go. And it doesn't even take that much. So that's why so many meditations are related with the breath. Because the breath is always present. It's a place of presence, right? So when you focus on the breath, that conscious mind, it can't go back and forth anymore. It has to stay here. Because it wouldn't make sense to think about how I was breathing 3 days ago. It doesn't really work like that. So when you feel the breath right here, the conscious of it, you go into a state of no mind. And it's a really beautiful place, and it's a magical place. So when we go into this place of no mind, it's a different part of our being all the time. So if you imagine our life like a really big forest, like a bush, a jungle, and it's full of trees and gullies and rivers and whatever, being in a state of mindfulness is like climbing the mountain in the middle of it. So you're right amongst it, and yet you're not of it. And you get an overview. You can see everything with perspective. When you're not in a state of mindfulness, when you're in this fluctuating mind, it's like you're amongst the tree trunks and the leaves, and you just can't find your way through it, and you're bumping into things, and it just all seems a little bit difficult. When you step out of that, you're in a state of no mind, and life becomes very, very different. Okay, so what is the power of transforming your emotions and mindfulness? Well, let's have a couple of little looks at how this all fits together. Well, we can't always choose the challenges that life brings, can we? Because we actually, if this is a school and this is a place of learning, then we are all actually here, and we will get the challenges that we need for our soul to evolve. And sometimes it's really easy to look at other people and we think, but their life is so easy, or Nina, you look like your life is really easy. I don't know, you're presenting here, someone gives you a great introduction, and they're not going to say, she was really upset 3 days ago because her car broke down or something. Doesn't really go with the sort of intro. But I was also one of those people that have had great challenges. I was doing everything right. I was very successful in design. I worked in Sydney and London in really high-flying agencies where we got to fly helicopters and do very cool things and feel like we were really important people. And it was really bad for my health. I got really stressed, and I became abducted by an Australian man and ended up here. And we did the whole downshifting thing and went to the Sunshine Coast and got my job in a very modest little agency, walking on the beach, doing yoga. I did everything right. I was a vegetarian for 16 years. I spent all of my money on organic food and farm markets. And there wasn't a thing I wasn't doing. And I woke up one morning and I was sick. And I was had to face the challenges of healing incurable autoimmune disease. And anyone that's experienced those things knows that it's really freaking scary when the body doesn't do what it's supposed to do, and you might think that the quality of my life is going to be shit after here. So I had to dig really deep into the genie of my mind, like to my subconscious mind, and go, okay, I did all of these things, but what did I not look at? And what is it that I am doing, thinking, and what's happening in my life that makes my mind think that it's appropriate to manifest these symptoms in my body? And that's a really true self journey. That's when all of these techniques and everything that I had was really put to the test, hey? So I've been teaching it and thinking it was amazing, but now I had to really use them. So I was really lucky because I had great faith and belief in the human body to heal. So being so well established in the alternative health and the alternative world, I really believe that anyone can heal anything. If you have enough time, and if you're given the right information and you have the willpower, you can heal anything. And the other thing is that I had amazing tools. I knew about the chakras, I knew about the emotional state, so when I thought it was all overwhelming and I could apply these techniques of sublimation, bring my energy up and take some of the edge of all these kind of intense things that I was experiencing, I could use meditation and go into a state of mindfulness and then get more clarity on everything that happened. So that's what happens. So when we do sublimation, it's a beautiful gift because it makes this state of mindfulness more accessible. So some of the really beautiful spiritual teachers today, and some of which I really admire, they teach really high forms of spirituality, and it's beautiful. We listen to it and it's like my soul wants to sing and I kind of really want to do it, but it's difficult. And it's difficult because our mind is so much in the more dense, in the more lower forms of consciousness that we have in our being. So if you can find the practice which helps bringing your energy up, where if that's, you know, we had crazy yogic friends, and I'm not suggesting you should do this, but they used to even put sort of bricks under their beds in India so that they were lying with their head down, so they continuously do sublimation and hopefully wake up enlightened or something like that. So really, it makes this state more accessible. And what also tends to happen is that what we experience as emotions, and if I can then make this idea that emotions are actually a place we find ourselves where we mix what's happening in the outer world with what's going on in the mind, our ideas of the fear or maybe ideas of the future or memories of the past, and we mix that in with what we experience and it becomes very emotional. And when we kind of bring the energy up, we can experience more just feelings, like pure feelings. So with that, what I mean is that I experience hot, cold. I might go, okay, I lost my job. Okay, I'm not gonna get up 6:30 tomorrow. I have to work out what to do for money. It's okay. Maybe wake up, you feel a bit lighter even, a bit freer. But other things come in. But and the other state, which will be kind of being swamped in the mind, in a more emotional state, will be going, oh my God, I lost my job, I am ruined, what am I going to do? So that would be more of an emotional state instead of just feeling what's happening right now. I'm sitting in my chair. I'm watching the sun come up. That's what you're feeling. That's what you're experiencing. So a state of when we do sublimation, this state of pure feelings, which then the feelings are just a beautiful communication between your outer and the inner world. It helps us to come to this state of mindfulness where everything that we experience is just as it is. So this picture illustrates it really well, and there's almost nothing really more to say about it because this state is just an amazing state, which is actually eventually a mystical state, where we actually get to step into this place where our mind is expanded and our mind is really free from all those preconditioned patterns that was put there before we really had a rational mind to access it or not. And we can sort of start creating those new patterns that we really dream of in our life. We can start implement and put into our subconscious mind some of those ideas that we had on our self-help workshop. And we had great aspirations, stars in our eyes when we came back from, and really start to bring them into the deeper parts of our being. And most of all, we're accessing this truly, truly deep mystical part of our being. And our inner dreams actually become our outer dreams. And this state of mindfulness could actually deserve just, there's still no mosquitoes there, by the way. And this state of mindfulness would actually deserve, you know, its own conference, and it does get its own conference sometimes. But it is a place where we're actually accessing the place in ourself which is eternal. So as simple as it might be, it's the most simplest of spiritual practices are usually the most difficult ones. It's actually easier to do this, because you can tell your body to do that. You tell the mind to be still, it requires a lot of training. So I don't want anyone to feel like they're failing in that sense. Any attempt is like worth millions. So in this place, what my advice and my true heartfelt feeling is that this place is a mystical state where your inner world and your outer world truly becomes heaven. And if you aspire to bring love and peace and harmony to your inner universe, then it shall also manifest in your outer universe, and we'll all get to thread heaven on earth as we are. So I would love us to actually do an exercise together. Have I got time for that, Anthony? Yeah?
Yes.
So I would love to show you one technique of sublimation from tantric yoga. And we're going to do it together, just a couple of little precautions, because it's one of those techniques, it's called Uddiyana Bandha. So some of you may be familiar with this technique and some of them you may not. It's a simple technique, you don't need to worry about having yoga clothes or anything. If you don't feel like doing it, that's okay too. It's not ideal in here because we don't have a lot of space and we do need a bit of space, so we're just going to sort of do it the best we can and walk to the side of the aisle or something. Just a couple of little precautions. If you have any major tummy injury, just skip this one. I just got to say that, like ulcers or hernias or something like that. And also, if you have a really heavy moon period, maybe just skip it as well. But other than that, let's do it together, and I'll show you this awesome exercise.
Or pregnant.
I can't hear what you're saying.
Or pregnant, sorry,
obviously if you're pregnant. Thank you, Anthony. So we're going to do this exercise. So basically the way that this works is called Uddiyana Bandha, which means the upward path of flight, which is really beautiful. And what it does is that in the same way as when we were kids, we used to go out maybe and play in the rain, and you kind of, the water might be trickling down a little hill. And then what happens is that we used to make little dams, right? And you make a little dam and it makes the water flow another way. So that's the same thing as we do with bandhas in yoga sometimes. It's a bandha, it's called a lock. And we kind of lock in the energy in one way and we force it to kind of go whoosh in another area. So this is a really beautiful exercise that what we do, we're not going to sit down like this dude, but I show my belly when we do this, but because there's so many of you, I felt a little bit shy. And I thought I'm just not going to strip my belly out. And we're going to do what we see this girl here do. And we're going to make this thing with our belly. It's not very difficult. We're actually just going to suck in the tummy. And what we experience is that the energy starts to flow upwards. Now, this is one of these kind of yogic exercises that not kind of as airy-fairy when we're kind of sitting by the waterfall and go twinkle, twinkle, little star. It's not as cute as that. It's a little bit more oomphy. It's one of those kind of we go, and kind of a little bit more willpower yoga. So we're going to do that together if you wish. You can get onto your feet and I'm going to talk us through it. So don't worry that we're not sort of dressed for yoga. In a way, I like that because sometimes we feel like there's so many things we have to fulfill in order to do these exercises. So I'm going to demonstrate it for you first, and then we're going to just do a few together and you get a little bit of a feeling for it. If you love this, it is, by the way, it's one of those kind of exercises that has accumulative effects. So when we do this, maybe in my own practice, I will do it for 10, 15 minutes, whatever. But you won't be doing that here for 10, 15 minutes. We're just going to do a few, just because I really think it's so awesome if you guys can leave with some practical tools that you can sort of try in your own time. Beautiful. Thank you very much, everybody.